Good morning. Wow, I am really excited. Such a crowd. We are just 5 minutes away for formally start. I just want to just welcome you all and make sure that you are situated. We're going to have fun. I'm going to start with sharing my story. And so just out of curiosity, how many of you would consider yourself to be Microsoft customers only? Means you're not partner, a Microsoft partner today. Well, I'd like you to be Microsoft customer only. how many of you would consider yourself to be, telecom background, coming from a telecom IP networking background? Awesome. All right, cool. And how many of you would be from Europe? Latin America? Cool. And the rest are my comrades right from the United States, right? You're not from America. That's awesome. Awesome. So, let last few folks settle down and we're going to kick off the things. All right, once again, welcome. My name is Amir Kaleem. I couldn't be excited more to see that so many people signed up for my session. And what qualifies me to stand in front of you? First, let me take a little bit of liberty and talk about myself. I want to keep it very interactive. Don't worry about it. I'm going to be in lounge as well. If I can't answer very quickly your question here and move on, I'll be available, make myself available in lounge beyond 20 minutes, and you can ask me all sorts of questions. So what qualifies me? You know, people like Tamur are in the room. I'm a little bit scared now. But what qualifies me to stand in front of you and talk about, you know, Lync or common concerns about Lync voice? Well, I started my journey as on the enterprise side. For bulk of my life, my professional career, I've been always on the enterprise side. This is the first time I'm working for a vendor. And I just completed 5 years in Microsoft. So it seems like yesterday, I just completed 5 years in Microsoft. What happened was that I was in a Swiss bank, and I was a IP network or data networking person there. I'd done all my certifications, highest of data networking, what you can imagine. And then I helped a bunch of folks there on some of their voice aspirations. So one of them actually became the owner of the end-of-life PBX replacement program in that Swiss bank. We could not even call it IP telephony for political reasons. So we called it PBX replacement program. And he tapped me and he said, why don't you come and do evaluation, selection, design, and deploy of a new phone system, IP telephony system, because you know the data networking side of the house and you know the voice side of the house. I started in Air Force working for a NATO-allied country where we were supporting Siemens and Alcatel and stuff like that, so I had rich background in PBX, and then I converted myself to a data networking guy. And I did that. So I said, okay, let's put a team together. This is around late 2005 sort of thing. In 2006, this gentleman called me up and he said, Microsoft is here. I was actually, by the way, that Swiss bank had about 900 plus PBXs, 110,000 employees at the time. Number of ports were more than that. And 80% of those PBX was networked together on net. 7-digit dial plan, unique for every employee. And that was QSIG of our choice, dissimilar, so, but 350 meridians, Nautel, about 400 Avaya, some Siemens, but Siemens were around 20, but about 40% of our organization was running on Siemens because we were a Swiss company and that's where it is. And then you can name under the sun, you know, we have Ericsson, Toshiba, Key System, Northstar, you can say that. So I'm not, these 900 PBX were the major ones. I'm not counting all of them. And, you know, he called me up and he said, and I was busy with my incumbent in the lab. I was one of the main authors of the RFP there, and we were doing this evaluation. I was in busy with, you know, traditional players, Avaya, Nautel, Cisco, Siemens. We were in the lab. We were very busy. I was heading in front of technical advisory committees, steering committees, asking for money for the pilot and blah, blah, blah. My boss called me up and said, hey, Microsoft is here. I'm from Chicago, by the way. And they are saying, we have a very slick click-to-call solution. Come and see it. This is what I told my boss. Really? You expect us to run our enterprise voice on Microsoft? No way. I have no time for them. So you go and look at, check them out. If you find something important, tell me. I'm too busy in lab. Mark said, all right. And I refused to see Microsoft. I'm a blue badge Microsoft employee standing in. I'll qualify how I converted my religion. So I went. What I learned, and in front of technical advisory boards, and I'm asking them for the money for the pilot, and the common question I get from the business, actual bankers who are on those steering committees, what are you going to give us? So your phone system is end of life. I'm going to give you a phone system. Said, no, we want more. I said, okay, explain me. What do you want more? I said, we want mobility. And that by mobility, they meant that we want to take their phone with them. So soft phone was in 2006. You know, you have to frame it in the right time. We're not talking 2013, where mobility means much more now. So and they meant soft phone. They want click-to-call. With click-to-call, they meant directory access, you know, because right now each PBX had its own directory, right? And then in Active Directory, you have slashes, parentheses, and all that thing, and they could not, you know, dial it. So they wanted directory access. And they talk about 7 features. We call them, so we put, when I say, the team, we put them, came back, put our heads together, and said, we're going to say them SIP value adds. Because one of the sections of the RFP was the SIP applications. And I went back to the vendor, usual suspects again, Avaya, Cisco, Nautel. You guys have any soft phone? Every one of them said yes. Oh, that was absolutely end of the story on my side. We got it. And I paid, you know, you could have any Ethernet cable or any power cable removed with 13 call flow scenarios, including on-net, conferencing, whatever. And it would not drop a single call. That was the criteria. The way we wrote the test plan and all that, that, you know, it was so robust. We were totally focused on back end that it would be rock solid. And that's what we delivered. At the same time, I had no idea that how many people I should put on soft phone and how many people I should put on hard phone. 80-20 rule applies. 80% on hard phone, 20% on soft phone. I was surprised. This pilot was done transatlantic, half in Zurich, half in Weehawken, New Jersey. We basically figured out that 60% of the people opted for soft phone. And 40% were this. But, you know, that was exciting. Okay, fine. You know what happened? That very early on, about 30 days into the pilot, people are calling us up and say, get me off this. I don't want it. And I mean, I thought that my bonus check that year would go through the roof. And here, people are trying to, you know, get out of the pilot. So I basically took upon myself, and I went to the various business groups, business units, and I interviewed people myself, what's going on. The common theme which I can report here was this. This thing, you said, we asked you for mobility, this thing doesn't work. What do you mean? It's keep re-registering. So, okay, I'll get to it. What else? We asked you for click to call. It doesn't do click to call. I said, I use it every day. It does. Show me what you're doing. So the person who was showing me, the very first thing that person did, and this is the hard way I learned, they went to their email, they copied a number, and cut, copy, paste, and the IP communicator and I-2050, at the time we both had, said, I don't know, where is 9-1? I said, no, you have to put 9-1-3-1. I'm from Chicago, so I will call 312. So 9-1-3-1-2-5-2-5, whatever. And so I'm not going to do that. So cut, copy, paste, drag and drop. You know, these are things I learned hard way through, that this is part of the user's head click to call. Click to call does not mean a very well-rounded, formatted number that they have to do click to call. And they give you one, maybe two chances. And then after that, this thing is for not me. That's what was going on. Second thing was that that re-registering thing, I was like, show me what's going on. So we put him, that person, to our guest network. And you know what happened? First thing he had to do was, from his laptop, he has to fire VPN. And then he has to register the phone. And during that conversation, the VPN flapped. Because I had not paid. I've not spoken to my security guys. I've not did VPN head end. Network is there. That's not nothing to do with me. I'm a voice guy, right? And I said, oh, look, it's re-registering. Oh, I said, no, it's nothing to do with me. Your VPN is flapping. They would look at me. They will not look at underlying network. That's plumbing to them, right? That was my problem. So that's, and now this whole list I put together is sort of an eye chart. I don't want to go through it, but I want promises that once you go out from this, you'll have very simple answers. You'll have truthful answers, and you'll also know where to find more information. I mean, if you look at this thing, people even have asked me I know them personally that they know, you know, voice, telecom. They know dial plan. They know everything. People even today ask me sometimes, Lync even has a dial plan. Can you even assign a DID? You know, that sort of question that come up. So what I've done is that I've bucketed them in these categories. So I'm going to go over the slides over these categories and hit upon them. If you have any question, just raise your hand. If I can answer quickly, I will right now answer that question. Otherwise, we'll take it on and we'll go to the lounge and explain more if you need more. Sounds like a plan? All right, cool, awesome. So architecture is the very first one. And that was the comment I was making, you know, that, hey, is that Lync server or 2010 was the first .1 architecture where Microsoft, you know, decided? Answer is no. Well, I'll give you this a little bit more. I take liberty and give you a little bit more story. You know, in LCS 2003 time, you remember somebody LCS 2003? Yeah? So large enterprises and customers like yourself, partners came and said, hey, Microsoft, this is good, but you know, we want marriage between our telephony and IM and presence. We want desktop marriage between them. So Microsoft scratched their head. They went to Nortel at the time, Avaya, Cisco. And you're looking at the line side protocol here. People usually, when look at the interop, they only talk about trunk side, right? So it's the line side. So Unistem, Skinny, DSCP, you know, Cornet, you pick the flavor. Everybody had their own flavor. So we could not possibly go and, you know, license every technology and then keep it. So it's not going to happen. There was one particular protocol which some flavor of that, everybody had it. And by the way, all the PBX vendors loved it when we positioned that. And that is CTI, right? Because they would charge for every leg of it, right? So we said, fine. And now think of this. In 2005, which LCS 2003 now become 2000, LCS 2005, I come to you and I say, I have a really cool click-to-call solution. Oh, by the way, it is on CTI. Even in 2005, you look at me and say, I don't think so. You know the limitations of it, not much investment is going on there, blah, blah, blah. What we did was, We hid the ugly baby with a pretty name, and we called it RCC, Remote Call Control. Everybody loved it, especially PBX vendor loved it. It sort become so, you know, prevalent that everybody thought RCC was a standard. Actually, it was Microsoft created term, and we all went there. Well, you know what happened? I mean, I was that part. I was one of the early users of RCC. I was very excited to get, you know, that 1140 Nortel. Anybody remember that? 1140 phone with the LCS. And I would dial a number on my computer, hit, and that will go off hook and do this. So a couple of times I did, oh, this is cool. And then I never used it. Because if I want to dial it, I'll pick up the phone and do it. Second thing was, I was not beginning to, so I basically called my LCS person up and I said, I don't want it anymore, disable me. You know why? What happened? I'm at home and I'm boasting to my wife, look, there's an incoming call, I attend. Huh, where is the call? A janitor in One North Wacker Drive in Chicago is listening to my call now. Yeah. Point aside, you guys want it, you know, the market wanted that, hey, we want a full-blown soft phone capability, full-blown client where I can take my number with me and I can do that. That's where we, the thing came in was OCS 2007 R1. That's where the full-blown dial plan and everything came up. So to cut the long story short, that we basically, this is a sixth generation software release for 2013. We know it. Not only that, if you look at the media stack, if you remember even NetMeeting and stuff like that on Live Messenger and all that, we have done a voice over IP for a very, very long time. You know, we brought about 8 billion minutes experience into the enterprise. You know, you're not controlling the call logs anymore. It's not going end to end in your defined network. It could be on anybody's network, sitting on a Starbucks or from home or this. You know, that's, so you need something in your toolbox, variable bit codecs, which we made that case, and at the time was a big hoopla that, you know, why Microsoft is not doing this, and this dynamic codecs are difficult to configure the network, blah, 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 but everybody then signed off and see the value. That's what it is. Now, the question was that there, we created the new world, right? There's still an old world, lot of investment in old world. Onus is on us, the people who created the new world, to build the bridge, right? Means if you need boss admin capability, you need, you know, 911 capability. You know, those sort of, or if you go to the IP networking side of the house, you need call admission control or QoS capability, malicious trace, you know, all those things. If you need those, that was on us, was on us, right? We created the disruptive nature of this communication, the solution, but at the same time, there was still need, business needs for that. So if you look at that, well, here is another thing. And this is how I was able to do the linkages in my head as that Swiss bank guy and figure it out. Because I was calling voice application, and when I was looking at it as an application, but when I started to do architecture or design, I would try to push it at layer 3. Because it was a layer 3 guy, you know, I was that too. So the thing is, voice is an application, and it has, either you can call it capabilities or features, I like to call it features, it has multiple features depending upon which business vertical you are on. But one feature which is extremely important and major contributor to the voice application is called dial tone. Other features could be, you know, conferencing, could be hoot and howler, even could be RF, you know, could be, depending upon, you know, IP turrets, depending upon if you're from financial industry, right? The point is, voice is not equal to PBX. Dial tone is PBX. So you could have a PBX which could deliver the dial tone, manipulate the dial tone, whatever 700 feature of PBX, they are for one sub feature of voice, not for voice itself. Out of those features, if you look at those so many hundred features which PBX vendors over the years of last 80 to 100 years have built, there are about 25 or 40 features that almost every organization uses it. Within those 35 to 40 features, there are about 12 features that almost all of us use every day. Make a call, receive a call, call line ID, auto rollover, you know, speed dial. You know, those things, are we use it. In R1, we delivered 71% of those. R2, we added more. And with Lync 2010, we basically, you know, delivered all of them, those 35 to 40 features. So yes, onus is on me as a Microsoft to deliver those capabilities, and that's what we did. But good news is that look at what we did in 2013. If you were in India, TRA, right? You basically now have, well, I was designing this for that Swiss bank. I ended up buying option 11 for the local market and option 81, which was connected to the to folks, my apologies, Nautil switch. Meridian is a CS1000, now they call it, or it's probably they used to call it. So we basically ended up two switches. You could have maybe an IP PBX from Cisco, and you could have one phone, but that phone basically registered to two different call controls at the back end, which may be deployed as a virtual, but they're two different PBXs running that. Now, sir, what we have done is we are delivering location-based routing. If you are a Hyderabad user, you have a Hyderabad DID, and you are visiting Delhi for a day, now if you pick up your soft phone and dial a phone, your wife in Hyderabad, and if it is going all over your network and breaking out from Hyderabad, you are not in compliance of Indian telecom regulations. I have a bad news for you. Your system must break out locally from Delhi. That's how they are. They want to protect the revenues of incumbent PTTs there, right? With a single software, you know, no two things, we are delivering that 2013. So I'm going to talk about, there are other things, a lot of cool things which we are doing. For example, Lync hybrid scenarios are really excite me that. So you'll learn this about more of that, but I want to highlight that as well. I mean, I raised this question early on, right? Think in this term. I'm a dial plan guy. Coming from that hardcore Cisco and Nautil background, that seven-digit dial plan on net, blah, 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 I cherish that. Very first thing when I was evaluating PBXs or vendors, PBX vendors, first thing I would look at that what is the dial plan capability they had. Here is the deal. PBX dial plan, PBX are designed to be connectivity to PSTN. Would you agree? Right out of the box, their whole tables and everything, their trunking, everything is designed to connect to the PSTN. When you connect to another PBX, that means that now you have to build a tie line. You have to define the, you know, how do you select that trunk and route up over that. It's you have to do something to do on net, right? You can't, it's not out of the box. It took me a while to figure out, you know, how, because I was that's what I said. Anybody remember Gurdeep Singh Paul? Gurdeep Singh Paul, he's considered father of Lync. He was the original person who came up with it. He was a Microsoft face on Lincoln, LinkCon, VoiceCon and Enterprise Connect. He was Derek Burney. Before Derek Burney, Gurdeep was. When I went, you remember I said I refused to see the Microsoft? My boss next year said, go and see Microsoft. I went to Microsoft in Redmond and they brought Gurdeep. And he exactly stood in front of like this in that Swiss bank audience and said, we can do your enterprise voice. And I said, oh really, here are seven call flows in the bank we do. Show me how you do it. He stood on the board, he started drawing, signaling, and all that. He did two, not all of them. Then he said, let me show you. That you remember that cut, copy, paste I was talking about? Dave Durbin is in the room. Dave was in that meeting, right? He just dragged Dave, boom, and dropped it. And I said, oh, hold on, Gurdeep. Oh, hang on. What did you, where is man behind the curtain? How did you drag somebody? I'm coming from a dial tone guy, right? And then he's clicking on a name and all those things. These things today looks, you know, trivial, but that was back in 2006, 2007, it was. So that's where, the point I'm trying to make is, the Lync dial plan is so cool. Let's suppose that, here, before I make this point, 900 PBXs, if you added one NXX or one new branch office anywhere in the world, you had to practically open 899 tickets. I'm exaggerating a little bit, but it took 3 months, up to 3 months, to go back to the business. Oh, you remember that? We office opened that. You can do on-net calling now. Given that we were the Swiss bank and on-net calling was encrypted, was so important to them, they used to laugh at me. Or, really? Now you're coming back to me? So Lync out of the box is on-net, and I'll explain you this. Let's suppose that today you open office in Timbuktu of 50 users. All you have to do is, first of all, there's no Lync user concept. We keep saying it, but it's not. It's Active Directory user. You turn on. It's a policy-driven architecture. It's the people. You just turn on voice capabilities for that user, which already exists in Active Directory, right? So you basically go, and for those 25 users or 50 users which are hired in Timbuktu, you just assign them the DIDs from the local carrier. And as long as Active Directory takes Active Directory to replicate, people sitting in Japan or United States or anywhere in the world can either dial by number or click to call. I don't want to call it dynamic dial plan, but you know, it's so cool. I don't have to go and open up 899 tickets to tell them that how to route back to it. No more. It's there. It's that awesome. You want to learn more? Go and listen to Doug. Doug is brilliant on dial plan sort of a thing. I mean, here is another thing. This question actually comes up. Do you even, very first time, one tier one carrier person asked me, I hear you run RTP over TCP. Can you believe that? RTP over TCP. No! Everybody runs, it's RTP, man. Everybody runs on UDP. So that's what it is. It's if you look at Microsoft, it's one thing which intrigued me was this. They have done on Lync product. I'm one guy who has a difficulty spelling AD, given my background, right? But this thing, they have done their homework. It's all very well documented. Not only that they have conformed to the standards, these documents, the way they have implemented those standards, they are available on MSDN. That is the coolest part, sort of a thing. So, absolutely. Second thing is people would say, would think that, oh, Microsoft only has proprietary codecs. No, sir. Microsoft has probably 7 or 8 or 9 codecs in that thing. You know, for example, if you want to do G722, it's up to the other party. Actually, other party, you could. If there are two endpoints trying to make a call together, and one happens to be a Lync endpoint, I initiate and I send, as part of session description protocol, I said that these are the codecs I want to connect. The other side would have to say that, yes, I support RT audio or RT audio or not, and that's what will force me. But guess what? Our partners from the line side, SIP line side, for example, SNOM or Polycom, and you know, others coming up very soon, if let's suppose the two phones registered to the Lync, SNOM phones, one, and you have configured, hard-coded that you need to do G729, and the SNOM phone picks up and dials 4 digits or 5 digits to other SNOM phone, you know what? Call anchored by Lync, it will be a G729 call, although we don't support G729 in Lync itself. We do not mess with the session description protocol. That's the beauty of this thing is. Here is another thing. So, well, I made this comment earlier. I learned it hard way through.
Are we allowed to ask questions?
Sure, absolutely. So audio is 722, right? So 264 is the video codec.
So it's just for video versus some of the other platforms like video where it scales both video and audio. This is Lync just for video.
Yes. So where were we? Hang on a second. Okay, here it is. So this one, when the interop comes in, and I learned it as leading the architecture at that, my ex-employer. Integration sounds very good word, right? It has two things in my mind, cost and complexities. I have to constantly maintain the versions and all this thing. Yes, I want that option. I want those knobs. But I want to make sure that I do not want a one vendor, PBX vendor C and PBX vendor A and say, hey, your QSIG, you said you support QSIG and you support QSIG, it didn't come up because IEs were not aligning, right? I want that it is shrink wrap for me. If you say it is, you are conforming to standards 3261, RFC 3261, then it should work. When I transfer the call, caller line ID and everything, and when I hand off, everything should work. That's what Microsoft did their homework again. What they did was that they not only that they conformed to the standards, they created interoperability programs. And instead of running those interoperability programs themselves, they went out and contracted it out to third parties, very reputed third parties like TechVisions or Wipro. They're on those labs. So if you happen to be any PBX gateway vendor of the world, you basically go to that interoperability lab, you sign up, you run through those 200 to 300 test steps. If you pass, you end up on Microsoft TechNet that you are qualified. Gateway, PBX, or SIP trunk provider, whatever it is. That is amazing. Not only that, we also took care of this on the line side as well. You know, think in this term. I think this is a bit old stat, but I'm going to share it from, I think when I was in the Swiss bank, this stat was shared with me that by 2013, we are already, UC business would be about 40 billion. I don't know whether it's true or not. I'm just making an example here. So out of that, 21.7 billion was going to be voice, traditional voice. And out of that 21.7 billion, about half of that going to be devices. You know, guess what? All the PBX vendors were jumping, yahoo, because they will discount their call control agent. They will discount your communication managers, but they will not discount that to that level to their devices. They make a lot of money on their devices. Well, that's, think in this term. We have never asked you to go and buy Toshiba, Acer, Lenovo, Sony, Dell, HP. We never. But the user experience we maintain, we work with these partners, we want to make sure that your user experience is the same. What we did to the computing market, that's what we have done to the phone market. You can go and buy the phone of your choice. If you like a handset, go ahead and try it. I still like to hold a handset. I still have to have that. What I don't really care that it connects to a USB port or RJ45, I don't. But I want that. So I use CX300 today, every day. What that sort of thing, you know, I'm coming. So not only that, we have done that. No, again, here is another thing. I said earlier a term used for networking plumbing. I think if you deploy, this is my personal opinion, if you deploy Lync full up stack and you know you have deployed it and you're using it, people are using it, you're still touching the tip of the iceberg. It's still plumbing in my mind. Think in this term, if I am a radiologist, somebody has queued from other side of the world an MRI scan, I really don't care right now that I need to talk to that physician in ER room to look at that number and try to call them and look for another device or another even soft phone and you know from my whatever machine, whether I was on iPad, Windows 8 slate, or full-blown Windows machine. I just want to look at that radiologist who has queued me and just make a phone call right from there and tell him that this area of the skull, you need to empty out the blood, otherwise this patient's life is in danger. That's what line of business application gives me. That's the communication enabled business processes. That's what I think is really this thing. Lync basically has the strength. Oh, this is my favorite, right? So we think in this term. We basically, when we did the soft phone 60%, very first thing was everybody got a disclaimer card that you have to sign that you're not going to hold that Swiss bank liable if you make a E911 call of that. Please do not use this one and use your either your cell phone or your desk phone or your home phone. Please do not do this thing. I'm not going to claim, I'm not a lawyer, but I'm not going to claim that we have solved the world hunger problem. But think in this term. E911, first of all, I'm hoping that everybody understands the difference between 911 and E911, right? 911 is simple, right? E911 is what it is that if I was working on a 29th floor of a building and I go on a 38th floor of the building, same building, either I take my laptop or I go into a conference room and there is a phone there and I sign in myself. Now I make a E911, a 911 call. When the emergency services come to the building, the building security will take them to 29th floor, not on the 30th floor. This actually happened in Chicago, that in Thompson Center, some lady in 2000 dialed a 911. They could not find her out. She ended up dying of the heart attack, right? So that's where there are about 19 states which are very stringent E911 law. State of Illinois is the number one in that. So they came up with this that, you know, within 40,000 square feet, you have to find the person in distress who has to make the call. Well, on the lighter side, guess what? Since 2002, I believe all the new buildings going up in Chicago downtown are 39,000 square feet per square. Well, still, right? So the thing is, if you are if you are on your network, your MAC address, your SSID, your IP address, which subnet you are on, I can find out where you are. I can do that. I can figure it out where you are, because I control the network, right? What if I am working from home? Hotel or a, you know, affiliate or somewhere. Then what? And that's where I usually go and work from. Well, I live 40 miles west of Chicago. My DID is from Chicago. Now I'm in my home and I fire up my laptop and I end up, for whatever reason, dialing 911 of Microsoft provided DID or Microsoft provided phone system. Do you want the emergency services to show up in Aon Center 225 Randolph in downtown Chicago? Answer is no, there's no use. They should show up at Aurora, where I live. Well, that's what we have done. we have taken the advantage of that PIDF allow, presence information data format location, which is NINA.gov, basically standard is on that, and that's what we have built upon that. And really cool. Still, if you want to still go that ELIN Ray and you have emergency gateway, Red Sky, or 911 enable and you want to use it, absolutely we can work with that as well. But it's a really cool thing. You don't need anything right out of the box. Location information service get installed on every front end server. You just want to define the wire map. It will do. If you go from the work, let's suppose if I was working from home and my home subnet is 192.168.1.0, which everybody probably in America has it, and I tomorrow go and Raj invites me and I fire up my laptop and it gets a 192.168.1, how does it know that I'm not at my home? I'm at Raj's home. Well, it looks at other things. It looks at BSSID, right? So it knows exactly the gateway MAC address, and it can uniquely say that I don't know where you are, give me the address. And that address, when you put it, it is a master street address guide format. So which is, you know, all you have to do is subscribe your service, basically. 911 is a patron. You can configure the emergency patron, for example, 112. My apologies if I don't remember what is the ITU recommendations are for rest of, you know, generally speaking.
The native capabilities are supported.
So you can configure that patron and you can define it as emergency route. Yes, absolutely. We can use them still.
But they don't have facilities outside of North
America. That is correct. So, well, you see, the point is in the product, in the solution, we have the capabilities. The services availability would depend upon the where in the world you are, right? That's, we don't deliver the 911 service ourselves.
Okay, but you are SIP-based, right? Granted, you are SIP-based. The Lync solution is SIP-based. Mm-hmm.
Yep, absolutely.
What do you do?
So that's what my apologies. I will give you a quick answer and then I'll give you further detail. There's a whole thing I can point you on TechNet. Thing is that we took the magic out. If I was sitting in my home, and I'll take example this and I'll give you that this is valid anywhere in the world. If I was sitting in Aurora and my DID was from a different PSAP, which is served by a different PSAP, and I dialed that thing, we took the magic out of resolving the PSAP, that which PSAP call needs to route. That's where the 911 enabled service which come in, and that will do it.
That's what I'm getting to.
Right? Second thing is that's sitting at my home. In my offices, in my branch offices, which is more prevalent scenario, that if I'm on a Microsoft office in Reading in United Kingdom and I'm dialing 911, then the call would get routed from the local gateway, which is connected to the local PSTN connectivity and point of presence. And that's where the services will.
So you have local solutions.
As well. Yeah. So that's what the comment, my comment was, that you guys understand the basic 911. So this, it has 911, was beyond that.
So it's not universal. It's not global.
No.
It is location dependent.
Yes. So it's.
In its way.
It's dependent upon the service available from municipal and civil services, what they offer. From product standpoint, capabilities are there.
So you have people in this room who are representing countries all over the world. You shouldn't really mislead them with a 911 solution, which is very specific to
solution. You probably better choice of word on my part. You're absolutely correct. But we do cater for the emergency services need of rest of the world as well in the product, not only for. This is probably example of North America. So maybe poor choice of word on my part.
It's just emergency services. We run in Northern Canada, Europe, Belgium, South America, and Africa. They're all configured for their local.
They're good solutions, but I mean, the way it was being presented, it was almost as if it was a uniform global solution. I think the 2010 solution is phenomenal for North America. It didn't really even exist before 2010. And that's why, and I had to really study that pretty deeply to see that to better understand it. I'm not trying to say it's not a good solution. It's actually better than, let's say, your traditional providers can do. But in terms of presenting it as a global solution,
No. I was by no means trying to present 911 as a global solution. I was trying to present emergency services as the capability. Example was the North American, right? All right. So can Okay, fine. Can this whole thing, you know, hold CIOs, if you talk to CIOs, one of the things on their mind is before cloud and now even today as well, how can they reduce the footprint? Can you virtualize this whole thing? Can you virtualize media terminating roles? With 2010, we delivered that 100%, and with 2013, we also delivered not on the server side, but also added on the client side as a VDI technology. So you guys are familiar with our, you know, virtualization story as well. This is actually very near and dear to my heart, because you can build the best rocket on the planet. If you do not have the right user manuals, nobody will know how to operate it, right? This is really cool. You know, I'm think in this term that telecommunications manager, if I remember from my Nortel days, ops manager, you know, there in itself is a whole infrastructure to stand up. You have to have a special FTEs who are trained for that and maintain that and operate that. Can I be, you know, use my existing, first of all, you have to purchase them. There's a cost involved with it, and OPEX, CAPEX and OPEX involved with it. Here, we give you all of these things, you know, from monitoring server, the CDRs, the billing, the call quality statistics, it's part of the solution. It's another server role, which is additional, considered additional software. You know, it is available as part of that, included in the licensing. There's no special licensing for that monitoring server. It's really cool. Not only that, we give you all of the management capabilities. You get the KPI, KHIs, you know, key health indicators. You can get synthetic transitions if you want to do that. You want synthetic testing, you want to do that. You can do that. All those things. This is really amazing. My apologies, I should have said that here, that if you need more information about this, I will encourage you to go and attend these sessions. These sessions will give you more information here. And I just picked, I like this slide because this was one of the slide for the monitoring server system. So I was a key guy. This was a key thing, one of the sections in my RFP when I wrote system management, system monitoring, system provisioning, system administration, those all things. Not only that, how do you do them securely, remotely, from anywhere? And also role-based access. You know, for example, the Timbuktu, there is no IT or telecom guy there that maybe admin assistant of the branch manager is the one who is responsible for this. How can he or she could just view that and can look at only their piece of it and not touch anything, all sort of thing. So role-based access and all those things becomes really cool sort of thing. Yep. Yes, absolutely. It was available from R1, R2, 2010, 2013. Yes, right. Absolutely. So we did improve a lot of reports, package reports. By no means it is a billing solution, right? And it's from a traditional standpoint, you know, billing, IT, MBG, I'm forgetting a lot of these applications are there. You know, you in a large corporations, you have multi-vendor PBX environment where you might already have a billing solution from somewhere. The cool part is that if you look at from that, they come in SL1 standard or something, they have parsers basically, they have collector boxes, polecats, all that, they connect an RS-232 interface and they capture that. What we do is that we provide that SDR store in a SQL format. So you don't have to do that. There are a whole host of partners who have built billing applications on top of it, basically. That's right. So not right out of the box, no, we don't provide any billing application. Well, I don't want to make any absolute statements. We don't do it today, right? But as a matter of that it's an SQL store, ODBC connection, you can suck it up and do whatever you want to do with it. All right. So as an architect, this was the thing. You do not want to kill redundancy by redundancy. You always design around single point of failure, whether it's an IP network connectivity or whether it's an application. Right? I actually get this question all the time. Hey, we get now 5 9s from other vendors. Did I say it correctly? 5 9s or 9 5s? so can you do that? So that's a very common question. So here is my argument to it. When I was writing an SLA for VLAN availability at my ex-employer as a layer 3 switching LUIT, global layer 3 switching lead. I had like more than 2,500, 6,500s I used to manage. And I'm talking VLAN, not WAN, right? Spanning multiple switches, right? I could not, with that leading vendor, I could not come up with that service description of more than VLAN availability of 99.97%. I'm not saying this is a standard. I'm saying for that particular customer, that particular it was. And it's about same if you go and do research and talk. 99.97%. I could not come up with more than that. What I'm trying to say is that you have to look at the availability on the dependencies. Regardless of whose voice over IP system you are on, if the underlying plumbing is not 5.9s or better, I cannot give you 5.9s. Can my solution be architected to match that underlying, you know, capability of high availability of 5.9s or whatever you desire? Answer is absolutely yes. There is no single point of failure in my architecture. We take care of from users to the site to the, you know, region to the world level. I would make this tall claim here that in a UC, full-blown UC solution, we are the only vendor who provides geographical redundancy, the true geographical redundancy. You could have a cluster, a pool in Europe and another pool in North America, and you can 100% back up each other. Well, you have to have your carrier arrangements. My apologies, Jay, I just want to make sure that I'm making the right statement. You have to have the right carrier arrangements to deliver the, but from an application standpoint, it's 100%. It's not like that you have a one cluster and you have a multiple nodes and different data center, and if that cluster cannot be backed up by another cluster. Our clients can simultaneously can talk to the two different pools, and if one pool goes down, which would be a big event, you know, because I, like I said, no single point of failure. If going whole pool down means that you connected all the nodes in that pool, all the servers on the same switch, and that switch was connected to the same power source, or whatever, right? Or something like that. So that's what it is. It's really thought of it from branch survivability, from that thing. I wish I could do a quick demo here, but I don't. This is 2013 architecture. Really cool. You know, that whole I was talking about geographical redundancy. There's a concept of pairing and all that thing. And I think I missed probably, yes. So there's, if you want to learn more about deep knowledge about this thing, please go and attend Subbu's session. He's going to take a brilliant job, and Subbu is brilliant on that. Let me say the way, first of all, from a branch survivability standpoint, no, sir, right? From a geographical redundancy and business continuity standpoint, yes, absolutely. And let me add to what you just said. So the comment was that in 2010, you have a branch survival appliance. If your branch gets isolated, you basically do get telephony functions. You can make and receive call. You preserve your 100% telephony, but that's it. So very advanced telephony functions like ACD, we don't survive. You know, while for you have to have a full-blown PBX, the other people do it. I mean, I'll make the case that, you know, what is the requirement, which is how much dollars you want to put in, investment you want to put in, sort of thing. But you're right. So what we have done is in that we are on a version 2 of SBA or 3. So we have enabled that value-add capabilities from our partners, gateway partners, who can build that capability to survive local response groups. So we have done something. What I want to get to that is that because we created that new world, the onus is on us that in that branch, with that GAD branch gets isolated, and if I want to IM my colleague in that branch, I should be able to do an IM, point-to-point IM. If I want to do a point-to-point video call in that branch is isolated, I should be doing it. That's what we deliver. So our branch survivability solution has two or three unique, actually I was going to cover that, so I'm going to go through that slide. Two or three unique things which I'm really excited to talk about that. One is that it is basically, it not only preserves the telephony piece, the dial tone piece, it preserves all point-to-point UC capabilities. That means IM, voice over IP, and voice over video, and within that branch, which is gets isolated. First, second thing is, in a traditional sense, if my WAN connection goes down, my phone re-registers to my branch. You know, not sir, not in this. We have thought it through. Our phone registers to begin with our local gateway, which is our local survival branch appliance, and if there's a WAN goes down, user gets just notification that, hey, there's a degraded services now because you lost connection to the mothership because of the network went down, right? You don't re-register. The user experience is not that, oh, I have to wait that it has to re-register. It's not like that. So that's really powerful in my view. Because when I was on the other side of the aisle, this was a constant complaint by the users. Hey, these things, you know, if WAN goes down, this thing re-registers. We have to make sure the key layouts and everything was matched. You know, the number weight is displays matched. Everything is there. So you just notify the user. Okay. Oh, this is actually, I would encourage you, these guys. So think in this term. There is a, coming from a traditional telecom background, there are two terms which probably all the telecom people know. One is called connection preservation, and another is called call preservation, although we should call it session preservation now, but connection preservation and call preservation. Connection preservation is that this is valid for any voice over IP system. You have two voice over IP system talking to each other, they lose connectivity to the call control agent. That's whatever the communication manager or PBX or whatever it was, you lost connection. The voice call stays up, RTP stays up. That's no brainer. What they lose is all the controls. You cannot hold the call, you cannot transfer the call, you cannot do that. And even if the connection is restored to that server comes up or the WAN comes up, you have to hang up. Actually, when you even hang up is not there, it's the timer. You know, idle, it's an idle timer for whatever it is, and after that it hangs up automatically. And then it re-registers, basically, right, phone. In our case, we call it session resiliency. Even if during the call, your session, your control channel, your SIP directly to the server, which it was anchored, if that server, particular server becomes unavailable or your WAN is gone, first of all, we maintain that call, but if that during that, that is restored, that connectivity is restored to the call controlling agent, to the front-end server, we will rebuild all the control. And I'll give you the example of that. If you had put a call on hold and your server had went down or your communication manager had went down, in a traditional solution, you will not be able to retrieve that call because that was called on hold when you put it down. But in our case, because we rebuild the control, you can retrieve that call.
Do you have a diagram of that here?
No, we don't have a diagram of that here, but I'll encourage you this. If you're on Lync 2010 or later release, means 2010 or 2013, make a phone call to a cell phone or anybody else, right? During that call, unplug your cable. Count till 10 and connect the cable back. See what happens. You will be amazed that it connects the call back. It's so cool.
That's what I mean. Where is connecting back to? That's why the diagram.
It's connecting back to the main server. As the underlying network gets converged, it keeps the architecture is intelligent enough to keep the logical channels open.
We can cover these in Ask the tomorrow.
Yep. All right, cool. So that, don't believe me on all these things. Go and check this report out. And I'll tell you what, I don't want to talk about the telephony pieces. You might have seen this slide and these figures before elsewhere as well. I'll tell you that you need to read this report from other things. Look at that. How they evaluated us on security, on our system administration, system provisioning sort of thing. Go and read this report. This is about, I think, 18 pages long. It is a really cool report. It's freely available. Mircom.com, they did it themselves, right? And the best part was it was done in Lync 2010 on a standard edition server, right? Not even an enterprise edition server. This is amazing. I have lived that myself in labs with Hammer, you know, pumping calls up. And it's not that you just pump the call up and the Lync attends the call. It is actually not that. If you read the report, you'll find out it is attending, you know, terminating the call and then transferring that call to the outside agent. So it's two functions. It's really cool. This is amazing. All right. Any question before we start off a little bit more about interoperability? Can we virtualize unified messaging? Answer is yes. Exchange can be completely virtualized.
Yeah, I have my infrastructure.
Yep, absolutely. Yep. Yes, so we wrote so question is that there would be a white paper recommendation on virtualization on Lync 2013. We did that for 2010, and by end of this month or earlier next, or a couple of, usually it is GA plus 90 days, we are writing that paper. I am actually part of that team who will get a chance to early provide some feedback on it. We are coming up with a 2013 virtualization paper update on that. All right, cool. Okay, I just wanted to summarize this. I talked about this, you know, that, hey, the whole interoperability, you know, we have thought it through. It is interop by design. It's not afterthought. We have thought it through. We have done this thing. We stood up this. We invested. We stand behind our solution. And we want to make sure that we are able to extend the hand, and anybody in the world who wants to shake our hand is welcome, including Cisco. Also, we are participating in the forums. Absolutely. These are, here is the deal. You already have investments, let's suppose, right? And you want to say that I want to leverage those investments as long as they're on the, my life cycle, there's still value left on that. They're on my books. Or you have end-of-life stuff which you want to get rid of, or you have a greenfield. Is this thing robust enough, Lync, can stand, is this enterprise grade, can it stand its two legs and deliver the enterprise great capabilities, voice capabilities to me? Answer is absolutely yes. You can deploy. These are the high-level three scenarios come to my mind that you can deploy Lync on. You can replace a completely PBX with Lync, and Lync becomes your PBX. Or you can connect it to the PBX. For example, here is as simple it looks like. I wanted to come up with that how, in a very simple way, I can, you know, show you that how do you interop. This is as simple as that. Regardless of whatever PBX, what you have, if, for example, your PBX cannot do SIP, you need a T1 or E1, absolutely, there are certified gateways for doing that. I just made it simple, one line, but you will need a gateway there. Again, this is very simple connectivity. There's no, you know, science to it. So if you want to, basically, if you want to replace the PBX, think about this thing. Tier 1 carriers, Swisscom, 94 PBX is retired. They're using Lync as their PBX. They're, you know, level 3 Sprint. These are tier 1 carriers. They know a thing or two about voice, right? 39,000 users of Sprint are on this thing. So this thing can really be your primary call control. You can completely, you know, go Lync as your PBX. If you say, no, I think we probably have our own PBX. We have invested in the desk, and we want to be more, you know, for example, we want to add capabilities. Means that we want to enhance capabilities, and we want to have remote workers, you know, people using soft phone capabilities. AD Kearney is, you know, around the world. You know, they have their consultants around the world. They are always on the road, and they use Lync as their soft phone. They don't ever come to the office. You know, well, their call manager infrastructure is still there, but it's, you know, they use Lync as their primary a phone system, which is connected behind Lync, but their trunks are still terminated on their existing PBX. Same is true for Shell. Here is an example of Intel. You know, they said, okay, actually, this is a slightly dated slide, Intel actually started to use enterprise voice capabilities of Lync as well, but they started from the conferencing. By the way, the connectivity which I showed you here, this is the same connectivity you require. You need to create a talk path. The same connectivity required for enterprise voice or conferencing, right? So essentially, you are not going back to the drawing board. So if you want to have conferencing, if you do this, the bank I was working in, we had 2,000 port bridge. It was actually three bridges, spectral Avaya bridges. We had 700 in North America. We had another 700 in London, and we had 600 port in Zurich. You know what? Guess what? How much it was oversubscribed? 2,000 ports. We used to do 18 million minutes in 2005, 2006 per month. It was 900% oversubscribed. You know why? Because people would book a conference call of 25 users, and only three would show up. And if I go by the booking numbers, I would never cost justify this thing. Right? If you look at the conferencing profile of your organization, you'll find that 80% of the conferences are internal conferences, team meetings internal. Right? Then you have internal in the sense that people might be outside your dialing in, but they're internal oriented. You might have another something like 15% of the conferences or approaching 17% of the conference where you have external participation. There's a hosted for external people. The purpose of that conference is that. Well, given the business, I want to be careful here. If you look at that, about 2%, 3% or less, depending on, again, which business you are, could be even services where you need white glove service, you're doing one-to-many scenario, or you're doing delivering training, webinar, you know, you sort of a thing, right? But a very large or significant number of your conferencing, if you do the profile of your conferencing, you realize that those conferencing, you can save that immediate benefit. Good example of this, nobody else, is Microsoft themselves. When MSIT started off with this, I was one of the big offenders of that because I remembered my MCI Verizon bridge number and my conference ID. Right? When somebody told me we need a conference, I immediately said, 800 this is my PIN, let's jump on this call. Well, after I think a couple of months of trying MSIT notification and all this thing, they said, okay, fine. If you want us to maintain your external conferencing bridge, we are happy to do that, but you as an organization is going to pick up the cost for that. Scott Brown, who's my boss, sent me an email. Next day I was switched. So practically we saved $11 million a year, Microsoft themselves, on conferencing alone. It's no-brainer. And this case study is actually, by the way, is available publicly. All right, so this is another one, right? Oh, man, this is my favorite topic, given my IP background, IP network background. Tamur is laughing at me. So the thing is, I'll have to keep going back to my home base. I was one of the co-authors of the QoS policy for that bank when the IP telephony and IP turrets and all those things started to show up on our door in 2005, 2006 timeframe. And this was the answer. We're not gonna trust any PC in the data LAN. Everything would be remarked on LAN access. No way. We're gonna put access list and we're gonna identify traffic, we're gonna identify the port, and we're gonna say which is trusted and not. So we did not, the trust boundary was LAN access, not beyond that. You know what? 18 months down the road, my service delivery guys, operation guys, were pulling their hairs. You know, this is nightmarish. You just created so much work for us, the administration piece. You have to constantly maintain the access list. You have to constantly do this. You move from one switch to another switch sort of a thing. You have to maintain all this thing. So we sat down, revisited, and we said, so then at that time, I've actually learned, because, you know, I was a networking guy. I knew that, you know, Cisco baseline architecture, and I built upon all this thing and all that. Finally, I said, okay, fine. Let's approach it from a risk standpoint. What is the risk? What we are trying to protect? The answer came back was, collective answer was, consensus was, we are trying to protect our slow WAN, which happened to be our branch network. Right? We did not have an issue of bandwidth in, you know, high-speed LAN MAN environment. Right? We wanna protect that whole thing. So we moved our trust boundary to the PC. And we basically said we're going to remark, re-inspect, and everything at the WAN aggregation. Not at the core even WAN, but the branch. But that was valid for that. I'm just sharing my experience. I'm not proposing anything here. Right? I'm just sharing my personal experience, what happened there. What I'm trying to say is that Lync is capable of doing this. Not only this, think in this term. There was another issue. The reason why we were so concerned was this, that any rogue application which can mark EF and start spitting out on my network through packet scheduler, you know, boom, I won't trust the PC. No, sir, since Windows 7 and later through policy, GPOs and everything, you can tie down that only link.exe or communicator.exe, the only processor which can mark EF. So you have a complete control over it, ironclad control over it, that there's no rogue application that a user can download and say, I'm going to start marking packets at EF, and I'm going to start starving your LLQs or priority queues. Right? So that's what it is. It is really, if you look at that whole QoS thing, it's a centralized control. It gives you a lot of control over things. Other than that, you have all other controls, you know, that call admission control, and we're going to probably talk about that next. Yeah, so this is another thing that, you know, can we differentiate between voice RTP traffic between this? Yes, so we provide the port separation, and you can define that, basically. And what this call admission control. This is, again, you know, can you do the call admission? Those controls are still available to you. And by the way, think in this time. I'm going to pose a question to the audience here. Let's suppose that I was a traditional, not Lync, but a traditional voice over IP, video over IP solution, right? I am a headquarter user. I'm allowed HD video, right, fully, and I'm a business user. I'm not an IT user. and my DID, I'm in headquarters. And what happened is that for a day, I'm roaming to a branch office which is connected behind a 5 and 12K, you know, link. Small branch office. I go and take my laptop, and I'm sitting with my buddy there and say, oh, let me show you a cool video. I can make a video call to the Tamur on the headquarters and fire up my client and I make a video call. What's going to happen to that branch? I'm going to fire up our 720 or 1080p from that, which is connected behind a 5112K link. What's going to happen to the branch? You know what's going to happen to the branch? I'm going to bring the whole branch down. That's what's going to happen to the branch. I don't know. I'm a business guy. I didn't care where I was. Not in Lync. It's a location-aware CAC. It dynamically knows, how do you say it? Dynamically knows that where you are, your personal policies, personal, you know, the things which are allowed to you are overridden by the site, the location where you are. It exactly knows where you are, and it will say, Mr. Kaleem, sorry, you cannot do video on this. Absolutely. Absolutely centralized. That's the beauty of this thing. Not only centralized at a pool level, at enterprise level. That is the coolest part. So you, let's suppose you happen to be in a European data center, and you create this whole world topology of your CAC policy server in your European pool. It will get automatically replicated to the, all the pools in the world. Really cool piece of that. And it is, I'll give you a couple, two more things which excite me about this thing. And this comes from that, you know, people who, I have a concept of this, you know, that traditional model that for presence, I need a presence server or presence or IAM server. For dial tone, I need an IPPBX. For conferencing and within conferencing, audio server, video server, web conferencing, or maybe one, but you get the point that I need all these things separately, sort of a thing. That's what I am an endpoint and I do an IAM. Right, so I set up, go to the my, I send a SIP message to somebody, you know, call, let's say, presence or an IAM server, CUPS server. I'll take a Cisco example. I go to CUPS, and I come back and I do IAM session. I want to escalate that to voice call. You know, I send another SIP invite to a Cisco call control, communication manager, right? And then I basically want to take it to the next level. Let's say I want to add up a video call or a web conferencing. I'd need to go to another SIP invite to this. In our case, under the same SIP session, that first session you created, you just add modalities. Means you add RTP streams and you can go up and down. The user, there's two things important to it. Why I'm saying this? One is the user experience. There's no multiple windows popping up or you have to click on the URLs. Second thing is that your priority queues where, you know, different call control agents are now involved, right? So that means that they have to manage their bandwidth themselves, right? Here, this case, it is basically the Lync server managing that. It knows that under the same SIP session, multiple things are coming, and it's much simpler to manage the bandwidth, that sort of thing. You could have said that, oh, that's why the session manager comes into the picture. Sir, in the most parts, both in our major competition case, that access are nothing but a SIP redirect server. So you send a SIP invite, it says, oh, you need to talk to this person on this modality, 302 message. It gets out of the way. It's not a stateful proxy, right? That sort of a thing. Now, last one, which is a really cool one as well, is that if you happen to be originating side, you could be any, not a Lync endpoint, non-Lync endpoint, as long as terminating side is Lync endpoint, we'll still honor the CAC. Really cool. There are a couple of other things as well on that. I'm gonna just skip through this, but this is our, you know, this is our sweet spot. Imagine, right? You don't have to fire VPN. I talked about it earlier in my opening remarks. This is awesome. This is no brainer. You do not want to. Do you want? Can you do it on the VPN? Answer is yes. You can do it on the VPN. But why would you put wrapper on top of wrapper? Right? It's end-to-end secure. It is TLS. It is really secure RTP right out of the box. It's not like that oh, you have to turn on the encryption. And by the way, when you turn on the encryption, now too, you have to start thinking about sizing up because your communication manager would go half in capacity. No, it's not like that. It's done. It's right out of the box sort of a thing. Okay? Also, management, everything is end-to-end secure. A little bit rushing because people are telling me that I'm probably running low on the time. That's what my comment from my friend was here, that, hey, you response group services. Why we call it response group services, anybody's guess, probably Tamur's bad choice, but ACD, It has built-in ACD. Again, no additional charge. And it's not a full-blown contact center, and it, by no means I'm proposing it as a replacement of a contact center, but check it out, its capabilities. It's pretty decent, right? It's really cool. And here is, if you want a full-blown contact center, that's what, remember I told you that what we did to the compute market, we did to the phone market, we're actually doing that to the contact center market and video market as well. You know, pick your choice. It's from high-end where you want a Genesis of the world, aspects of the world, to, you know, low end, what do you want to do? You know, from a five agent concurrency to all the way up to 1500 agent concurrency, what do you want? Pick your choice. And what we have done is we have worked with them and we have certified and qualified them so that you get a peace of mind that it would work, right? Voicemail solution came up this. Lync only works with UM. And here is the reason I want to qualify why I'm saying that's it. You know, it all the bells and whistles. It basically lights up this thing. Converting an email into voice call or converting a voicemail into a full-blown video call or conferencing call, those all things, this come from bells and whistles. It's all there. You know, I, for example, for my when somebody leaves, first of all, nobody leaves me voicemail. That's the problem. I never delete my voicemail now. Because the moment I get a voicemail, I keep it for demo. Because everybody knows my presence, nobody leaves me voicemail. But if I get a voicemail, I read them. I don't listen to them. It's a little bit improved. Somebody can help me in the comment. Was that is that preview has improved in 2013, Lync Exchange 2013? My answer is yes to that.
Definitely.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, because that's yes, agreed. It was. We basically claimed around 70% accuracy on that. Right? So we didn't claim it 100% to begin with on that, right? But with my accent, even with 2013, I'm sure I'll sound like a comedian on that.
No, I just support. We've had some interesting.
Yeah. Yep, no, I agree with that. So,
so if you had, let's say, Brand X was your voice solution interoperating with Lync, you couldn't use Exchange UM in that case.
No, so Exchange UM independent of Lync, if I understood your question correctly, Exchange UM independent of Lync can be deployed against all major PBX vendors.
Okay.
For Lync. Lync voicemail solution is Exchange UM. Okay. And we basically see from this lens. We see that, you know, from IP, if you need an IP phone, you need a phone set. Like I said, I'm a guy who likes to look and feel and think of that. You need a thing, we have phones for you, right? And we categorize them in this, you know, our phones basically, that you have a knowledge worker phone, you have a common area phone, and your conferencing phone. You can get whole more of that information in tomorrow's sessions.
What about Boss Admin?
Yeah. Okay. So we did deliver Boss Admin in 2010, but there were some pieces missing, right? Some capabilities missing. For example, you could not, share line appearance was not there. For example, you may not be able to transfer directly to the voicemail from CX600 sort of a thing. And what we did was a couple of things. First of all, we did some improvements on the Lync side, and some we worked with our partners. For example, shared line appearances, we are delivering with our partner solution like SNOM. We are also adding that if you look at that right SNOM 37 with a sidecar, basically, right? So that if you wanted the sidecar and the presence of BLF information of everyone, you get that now with that as well. So yes, absolutely, with 2013, there is improvement in Boss Admin was one of the key investment areas within voice feature set. Yep. That sort of a thing. So voice over IP, you know, look at this. Your choice. We are not saying that you have to only buy from me. I had a traditional PBX vendor, core A, core B. There was a high speed path crossover cable between them. I looked at this and it has a part number. And said, hey, didn't you say this is a crossover cable? So yeah. Said, why there's a part number on it? Can't I use this, so many lying here? Said, yeah, you can use it. So I said, why part number? Well, because if you use and not without part number, we will not support it. So for, very first question coming to me, what is the cost of this? $175. They're not in business today, by the way, that PBX vendor. So that's what I'm trying to point to make. You know, your choice. I can't even tell you how many of them. Well, last probably when I checked, it was like 100 plus. 140, there you go, right? It's difficult to keep track of that. How many people are coming up with the devices and the user scenarios and all that thing? The good people from Plantronics, Jabra, Polycom, they're all here. Sennheiser, you know, they, yeah. Okay, so that means, okay, fine, you provided us IP phone. So what we did was that, so the question is that all the IP phones can find the Lync server, edge server on the VPN as well? Answer is yes.
No, outside of the
VPN. Outside the VPN, yes. We don't. I can answer more details on that as well, right? Yeah. Well, the interesting story, I probably think I should be running and I shouldn't be going to stories, right? thing is this, if you want a phone today, I'll define phone for you. You do this. You do the justice whether this requirement, has, the one I'm requiring is fine or not. I want a phone which is a color screen phone. I want a phone which is a photo enabled. I want a phone which gives me access to my corporate directory. I want a phone with a two-port switch so that I can connect my PC behind it, right? I want a phone which is a class 2 phone. It's a color screen, but it's a class 2 power over Ethernet so that I don't have to go and completely do anything. And I want a phone which has access to my calendar so that if I want to join the meeting, I can single-click join the meeting. By the way, I want that phone of MSRP less than $300. Go figure. Right? That's what I'm saying. That I'm not saying Microsoft or Polycom or you know HP phone. I'm talking about a specification of the phone. That's what we deliver. Right? It's awesome. Yeah. So analog ports, absolutely. We can. Well, we basically, one cool part of this thing is that although that analog phone is connected to the gateway, not to Lync directly, we still manage for the CDR standpoint. We do the administration of that thing. We can define all if you want, class of service restriction, who dials what, who can dial 1-800 number or 900 numbers or whatever. Yes, absolutely, we can do that as well. By the way, this was an important point here. I'm going to go back from a management standpoint. You know what? You don't require any dedicated server role to deliver firmware or configuration. It lives on the front-end server called update service.
Can you, with 2013, or are there plans on the roadmap to be able to deliver updates in groups rather than a big bang?
So in, even in 2010, you could do that. You could select that these people, you can then roll back, and you could do all those things. Ask me or Tamur after the session, and we'll give you more details on that.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, you can maintain that. You can say that only these devices get upgraded, these don't get upgraded.
Right.
Yep. All right, so I want to talk about this. You know, we have all the conferencing phones and all this thing, putting some sessions up there if you want to hear more about conferencing. You heard Tony and Derek this morning. I'm going to just buzz through this, that we have this. Now, we delivered. We promised voice over IP, voice over video. You know, we are delivering those. You know. So, no, sir. So, 2013, right? We are in 2013, right? Lync app. Well, here, I'll go back here. So, you know, you could be on a browser, you could be on a tablet, or you could be on a PC, right? So, if a browser, they were showing on Safari, right? You could be on a Firefox, you could be on Safari, that's browser experience, Lync meeting experiences, and platform independent. But if you're on a device, then a device-specific client is made available through the store. And this is you've seen them in life, so there's no point showing them right now. Yeah, that, so I'm... No. You have to download from per device basis. Yes. Yeah. It's a store model. I'm running out 2-3 minutes. I'm thinking which I'm interested in on this, right? So you know that we are delivering the Skype. You saw the call, so I'm going to skip those things. Why it is so big deal? Why you're making so noise? These numbers actually, you know, this is the reason we make so noise. Think in this term. One, I think over 1 billion identities we manage in Skype. Out of those 1 billion identities, we consider 300 million connected users. The definition of connected users are that who use Skype in 1 month for 100 minutes. And out of those 300 million, 40 million are connected on concurrently at any given time. This is, and out of that, 50% of the world traffic, you know, of the Skype traffic in the world is video. And we carry about 25%. You saw this just report came up with, you know, 25% of the global minutes are carried on the Skype network, right? That's really, really amazing. What it means, this is what it means, that we know exactly how to buy, you know, dial tone, how to connect, how to sell dial tone, how to provision, how to get services, who can dial what, blah, blah, blah. We know exactly how to deliver. This is the model we know for last 100 years. We exactly know how to provision it, how to maintain it, how to purchase it, what to do with it. This is connected to a public cloud called PSTN. There's another public cloud there, Big Eye, where all these people who are there, my daughter has no problem to get on this, that my dad last night, you know, told me that I have to be home back 10 p.m. and I came at 10:15, and my dad sucks. She's going to go and say that on that. She has no problem speaking her mind, right? This whole instant communication people who are on Facebook.com, Skype, Yammer, you know, they want instant answers. Right? There are about more than a billion people out there, right? I mean, think of this term. People tell me, go to facebook.com/your bank or your airline, right? There's really cool web page. People like their products. There's no meaningful way to start a communication back to the people. That's where I'm on my Skype interface. How you do that? Can I open up this whole wild, wild west to my organization? Answer is no. The bridge connecting these two clouds together in a meaningful way, in a deterministic way, is Lync. It's the 21st way of doing, century of way of doing, you know, communication, and in 20th way, how do you connect them together in a very controlled fashion? What gets out, what gets in, how securely you do it, that's what it is. Now think of this term. If I'm standing here on this side and I look at the PSTN, does it matter that PBX is there or not? Not really. It's there. If it's not there, doesn't matter. It's just a gateway. It's a conduit to me. I really don't care about that. So that's what basically excites me about this thing, new thing. Last piece is, okay, you delivered all this cool stuff. Can you support it? Answer is yes. As you leave this room, there are people standing behind you to hand over your flyers. If you take these flyers, if you have any feedback about how do we support and the delivery we are doing through our partners, we'd love to hear from you. Please give us that. Key takeaways, this thing is robust. We have three key strengths, you know, that we can deliver your voice. I just picked one workload, voice, and talked about that. Second thing is our ecosystem. We are not, when you get Lync, you're not just buying Lync. You're buying the whole strength and power and footprint of the whole ecosystem of Microsoft partners and everybody this. And second is, I would submit this to you, sir, that given that whole total cost of ownership, if you look at it from a UC standpoint, we will always be a better value for you, right? I hope this was useful. My apologies to rush you again.